And there is a lot of division in the Democrats. They're trying to present this picture of one big happy family and united, but Biden's obviously angry. He's not even there. He's not talking to Nancy Pelosi. It's going to be interesting to see these rifts, and someone's going to write the story one day about how that coup happened. Who made the final call? Was it Nancy Pelosi? Was it Barack Obama? Was he threatened with was it 25th Amendment? Will we one day know how it all happened, Ami?
It's yes, yes, and yes, yes. It is all of those things. I mean, yeah, they're definitely trying to make it a happy-go-lucky, we're all one big family. I know that watching CNN's coverage and MSNBC's coverage of the DNC, they certainly are putting on the happy face. They're talking about how wonderful Tim Walz was, what a great choice it was. It was a massive, unforced error by Kamala and the Democratic Party to pass over Josh Shapiro, who may have given them the election, like you said, because really the ball game is Pennsylvania. Whoever wins Pennsylvania is going to win this election. He's incredibly popular in Pennsylvania. And they chose, let's be honest, this is a far leftist wackadoodle who supports people who have stated support for October 7th. Right? This is a guy who has said who would try to push through an agenda of taking children away from their parents who are transgender. And by the way, that's a real thing. I know that the Democratic Party and the media carrying their water trying to say it's fake news. It's not fake news. I went into it. That's exactly what the courts were going to be emboldened to do. It was a massive mistake. And I think, look, if she loses, I think we can go back and point that and say that might have been the reason why she ended up losing.
Well, not only is he a far-left socialist, and he's proud of the socialist tag, but, you know, putting tampons in boys' restrooms throughout schools, but he's a governor of a state that doesn't matter. So how she could have made that call is beyond me, and if it costs her the election, well, there'll be a few books written about that. Now, Donald Trump held his first outdoor rally since the assassination attempt on his life just over a month ago. He appeared behind bulletproof glass alongside his running mate, J.D. Vance. This is a sad development, Ami. It's necessary, obviously, in the current environment, particularly when you've got the Democrats en masse calling him a threat to democracy and a threat to the future of the Republic. But to see him behind that glass, I think it's an indictment on the current state of things in the U.S.
It's in particular an indictment of the Democratic Party and the left, right? Because you don't see Joe Biden or Kamala Harris having to hide behind plexiglass and bulletproof glass. I think it's a hallmark of the left. I did a video where I walked around the day after the assassination attempt asking people in New York how they felt about it. And the vast majority of people I spoke to felt it was a lost opportunity. They hoped he was killed. They wish he was killed. Yeah, look, I mean, I don't want to waste the time of your audience going through the list of leftist violence. But Steve Scalise, congressman, Republican congressman, was shot by Bernie Sanders supporters at a congressional baseball game. Supreme Court Justice Kavanaugh, assassination attempt in his home. And of course, Donald Trump. This is a hallmark of the left. They use violence as political means. This is nothing new. I think you can go historically and look at the left and see that they use violence because it's the only way they can get their agenda pushed across. It's a problem. I'm not saying that there's no violence on the right whatsoever, but if we look at modern day history, we can see the majority of it's coming from the hard left. Not left of center Democrats, but hard left people who are part of the Democratic constituency. This is where most of the violence is coming from, if we're being honest.